wanted to say thanks for coming along this evening. It's great to see such a big turnout. Pretty much packed the room. So, obviously, we've got a couple of really good speakers this evening, Jim and Margaret Cuthbert, who are going to be talking about the economic case of Scottish independence, which is kind of nitty gritty that the No campaign are so keen on picking on. So, it's great to have those four speakers to talk about the positive case and prove that. We're not too rigid, or too stupid, particularly not too poor. So, without spouting too much now, I'll hand over to people who've come to here. So, Jim and Margaret are going to talk for about 40 minutes between them, and then some time for questions and stuff at the end.
Okay, and Jim Cuthbert.
Margaret.
We're going to do another lag between us. We're passing for 5 minutes, we're going to talk. If you'd like to talk a bit, then Matt and Margaret will finish off. I'm a former academic and government statistician. I'll tell you about myself, introduce yourself. If you want to know more about us, go to the website, the address is there, and almost all of our papers are on that website. And if you want to dig into the papers that we're referring to tonight, we'll be on that website. And briefly, I'll pass over to Margaret. What we're doing tonight, we're looking at some assorted topics relevant to the independence debate. In particular, one of those topics that we feel unduly neglected to the disadvantage of the Yes campaign. So we'll give you some interesting food for thought. But without more ado, I'll pass over to Margaret.
Hello, and I too am a former academic and ran a consultancy, a business consultancy company. Anyway, just to get straight into it, perhaps I think the biggest misconception that those in the Better Together or No campaign have is that the UK is some strong, stable economy, and really we should all be dying to get into it and be willing to put up with a lot because it is such a strong, stable economy. It's almost like one of these big insurance companies get it round about you and feel better. And what we'll do tonight is showing more than anything else that that is not the case. And in fact, we feel that the Yes campaign needs to change its tack and make it apparent to people that staying in the United Kingdom is not staying in some wonderfully strong fortress, but in fact is clinging to a dying ship. So Jim was saying we're going to be looking at some of the economic topics that haven't really been given too much attention to date. And here actually we're looking at some of the issues that will be surrounding the sharing of debt. You know already that we've said how can Scotland possibly afford the amount of debt that we would inherit when we should we choose to leave the United Kingdom. So Jim will be talking about that, and he'll also be talking about how is it possible that the UK is itself at risk of some systemic failure. What I want to be talking about is, first of all, what are the downsides if Scotland continues to remain part of the United Kingdom? Well, the first thing we've got there down there is the continued economic austerity. Well, as you know, the budget was today. There was absolutely nothing in it really of much importance for small and medium-sized businesses. Scotland is primarily small and medium-sized businesses, especially in areas like this. So there isn't much going to improve growth in those areas. And where we had been told earlier on that we were going to have, after the 2008 crisis, there was going to be a rebalancing of the British economy. As you well know, we have indeed finally now got some growth. But although it looks good, and that growth is now higher than some other countries, they have steadily been having growth all the time while we were having such a fall in our standard of living and such a poor performance. So in fact, although they can point to we're now doing well, it's not very good relative to, and in fact John Swinney said it better tonight, relative to how other countries have been doing in the past, certainly the past 6 years of 2008. So the big problems there, and that economic austerity too is not uniform throughout the whole of the United Kingdom. While we and many like us in the rest of the UK have been suffering, London has been striding on apace and has for economic growth and increasing inequality. And it's the increasing inequality that I'd like to point out to you this evening, that we are getting two types of inequality, that between the rich and the poor, but we're also getting very, very big differences in inequality among the different countries and regions that make up the United Kingdom. In fact, when Eurostat did a study of average wages and incomes across all of the different parts of Europe, the UK had the highest difference between a low-earning area and a high-earning area than any other part of Europe. It's not something that is to be admired, and it's not something I think that most people here would want to continue. The state in the United Kingdom, there's no way of getting around that, because nothing has been done to alter it. The next one is actually on the Scottish economy. It's likely to be affected by the Callanan changes. Now, when you go to our website, if you do get the opportunity, you'll see we have written against the Callanan changes, and it was only at the last minute that the SNP paid for it to go forward. The Callanan changes affect the amount of income tax that the Scottish Parliament will be able to raise in Scotland. At present, it's 10 we will be able to raise once it starts, 10 pence of the 20p bracket, and also 10 pence of the 40p bracket. But we have shown that it's got some perverse problems with it, particularly with things like fiscal drag going on, which again was one of the issues that came out in the budget today. So given that the panel, as we introduce these changes, we will start getting cuts in the Barnett formula to accommodate these changes, we believe that Scotland is in a worse off position, or could very well be in a worse off position than otherwise. At the minute, we fail to benefit from Scotland's natural resources, and by natural resources, including in there oil, land, whiskey, and the talent of our people. It's quite frightening, actually, if you have the chance to go and look at Scottish higher education figures of young people leaving university. And first degrees of young men of Scottish domicile leaving Scottish universities, only 38 in every 100 managed to get a graduate level job in Scotland. They might get jobs at Tesco's and Boots, etc., but only 38 out of every 100 when the first graduate actually managed to get a job at graduate level. Clearly some will want to go on and do a PhD, but many don't, and many actually are forced to go on and do a further degree because there are no jobs here, or they're forced to emigrate or take a job which is at a lower level. And finally, on this one here, this slide, someone made the comment, now what was it, Jim, the other day about Malta?
I think it was Ken Clark said that Scotland got independence with the same influence as Malta. And, you know, one of the things that's right with me certainly is that many of these people have seen that less influence than Malta because they're sitting with our seat in the European Commission, whatever.
So it's quite incredible that it was that one that he actually used. Moving on to the next one. I've been doing some work just now on mergers and takeovers. Some of the ones that totally infuriated me, you know, you probably know all this already, but when people are speaking of mergers, they quite often speak of it in a very, especially politicians, in a very upbeat way. Here is a company in Dumfries and Galloway. It's terrific at IT. It's actually not very good at marketing, not very good at maybe its management, not top notch. It's got such a good idea, it wants to expand worldwide. It could expand with IBM or some other company, Lockheed Martin. And so it's sold to us as being, and this will help jobs, etc., etc. What we found out actually in the 2000s, especially up to 2008, is that many of these deals, the mergers, were actually debt fueled. The great one, of course, was in Scottish and Newcastle, when it was bought over by Carlsberg and Heineken. up its money entirely with debt. We didn't want actually the Heineken family to have its shares diluted. And Carlsberg, who'd wanted to put a share issue, had to do it by a bridging loan because the market had fallen. So in other words, we're allowing our firms to be bought over by other firms that are saddling themselves with debt, which makes them actually very unattractive for quite a long time in managing to keep the productivity up. The Royal Bank of Scotland, unfortunately, fuelled an awful lot of the money for some of these transactions. We would like to see a huge difference made in mergers and takeovers, and in that companies such as Scottish Power just can't be taken over without a huge national public interest debate on the subject, and the workers play much more of a role. We don't think it's right, for example, although it's not so much an emergency and takeover, obviously, that, for example, Scottish Water has got rid of so much of its professional and technical staff and now buys it in from other countries because it doesn't have the expertise any longer internally. Mm. To date, we have been unable to use any flexibility that exists within new rules, for example, to vary taxes like VAT. If you go over to France, go into a cafe, ask for the bill, and look at it, you'll see that the VAT rate in there is far lower than ours. That's because France has actually used its discretion and its ability to vary VAT to help the tourism industry. Also uses VAT changes to help the maintenance, you know, house maintenance, plumbers, electricians, etc. in their job. Gordon Brown refused to do that particularly. He's now saying that we would be holding income tax. Well, that would have been a very good one to help out upon it. And he refused to do it. The next point I think Jim should mention.
Well, this one relates to the some work we've done on the pricing method for utilities. And this method was introduced after Margaret Thatcher privatised almost all utilities in the UK. She didn't privatise Scottish Water, but unfortunately we use the same pricing method. And what this method does, it's based upon what's called current cost charging, and effectively it puts us, the customers, in the position of people who are renting the capital assets. It's a bit like the difference between if you rent a house, then your rent will go up within, you know, every year with inflation. If you buy a house with inflation, eventually you'll reap the benefit of inflation and your mortgage charges will be fairly minimal. Well, because of this current cost charging method, we're in a position of renting the capital assets which formerly belonged to us rather than owning them. And the inflationary benefit accrues to the utility companies. And in the case of Scottish Water, to the Scottish Government, who uses an extra form of taxation, rather than to us in terms of lower charges. This issue is a bit more complicated than that, because in addition to that fundamental theoretical flaw, the way that the regulators have applied the method has been crass, they've been based on states. So huge profits are in privatised utilities. So when you hear about the takeover frenzy for water companies in New Wales, etc., and huge profits, it's all explicable in terms of what's not the price mechanism and could be cured. But it's not been cured in the UK. So.
The last one I've got there is about
losing
qualified young people. Well, of course, every person in this room is well aware that that's happening, and I've already given you some statistics on it from higher education. But if I could go on, and it's not on the slide, if I could also say that there's a paper which is on our website, the Dysfunctional UK Economy. It was produced last May. With any luck, we'll have another one out updating it this year. It took us into all of the different main indicators that are useful in the economy, and it compares Scotland with all of the other areas, countries and regions within the United Kingdom, Scotland's performance against them, and it also compares, where possible, either our performance or the UK's performance against many of the other countries in Europe, ones that we would consider to be our competitors. And it goes through whole lots of variables in there, like unemployment, length of unemployment, those who are disabled, those who are getting attendance and disability allowances, and what's happening. to the business world, what's happening to research and development. And we find in many of these that the big, huge problem in the United Kingdom is that it is not united. The deviations across the country from Scotland to Wales, Ireland, Northern Ireland, and the other regions is shocking. But as well as that, we're not doing well relative to the rest of Europe. The amount of effort that's put into research and development is nowhere near enough to get that structural change in the economy that we're desperately needing. And part of that is because the taxation policies for research and development, or the encouragement that we're giving to it, is inadequate. But much, much bigger than that is that we are not in control of some of our major assets. So, for example, the whiskey business, although they said tonight that that was going to benefit Scotland from the not increasing the price of duty of whiskey, Diageo actually owns a hanging lot of the names, and they own them through subsidiaries in Holland. Diageo paid 2% of its profits in corporation tax in the UK. The UK government is either incompetent, corrupt, or ineffective in raising corporation tax. Scotland's not benefiting from the whiskey industry the way it should be benefiting. And as far as North Sea oil goes, again, we'll have to consider a range of figures, but we do know that approximately £20 billion worth of oil industry goes straight out of Scotland in the form of some form of profit. It just doesn't touch the sides. Now, if we were independent through our licensing system and through good relations with oil companies, we will be trying to make sure, hopefully, that more of the research and development and more of the related industries will join up with it, and so we will be far, far more efficient. And the final thing, of course, that bothers us all is the financial sector. You might have heard Prophet Beveridge say the other night, well, the Royal Bank of Scotland has to go, it has to go. But what's definitely what we want with an independent Scotland, which failed entirely through the system was set up by Gordon Brown, which was anyway, the scene was set by Margaret Thatcher, etc., is a financial services sector which is out of control. We can't afford that to go on that anymore, and it produces such a difference in incomes. Again, it's undesirable.
Thanks, Margaret. Okay. Margaret's been was talking about what happens essentially on the status quo if we keep within the UK and the wheels don't come off. What I'm going to be talking about next is the chances of the wheels coming off within the UK, which I'm going to argue are actually significant. I think this is very relevant to the whole question of independence, because my own view on independence is that countries tend to get independence at cataclysmic events, like collapse of empires, like the end of world wars, like systemic economic crises. And I think our chances may be rather better at the systemic economic crisis than the forthcoming referendum. So the chances of systemic economic crisis are, to my mind, something that's extremely important in terms of the independence debate. Now, we know that the UK is not exempt. We don't float above the surface of these things. In 2008, we were within hours of the cash machines not working, and our major banks going belly up, and goodness knows what would happen. So systemic failure, systemic crisis of the UK economy is not something remote and unthinkable. It dashed in, it happened 6 years ago. But have we learned this? I'm going to argue that certainly not. To understand why I'm arguing this, we need to think a little about the UK's economic history since the Second World War. And there are certain aspects of that are very important. One is that if you look at the competitiveness of the UK, there has been a long-running decline, a long-running trend of decline in competitiveness. And the effect of that has been a chronic worsening in our balance of trade in goods and services. We are now in a chronic and significant deficit in our balance. really started to become bad, in the oil picture, in the early 80s. And since the early 80s, we've funded ourselves effectively by two things. First of all, particularly in the 80s, by oil. Margaret Thatcher took oil and spent it on a number of things which didn't give us a long-running benefit. But the oil is declining, and what we've been doing more laterally has been relying very heavily on borrowing and also on the activities of the city. The way the city works is we're currently earning via the city a surplus from overseas, which costs up our balance of human deficit in goods and services. So, in effect, since we're living by borrowing and by various activities, the UK economy has been turned into something which is rather like a large bank. The analogy is not mine, it was made by a chap called Stephen McHale, who is a respected economist and former member of the Bank of England Monetary Policy Committee. And in a paper round about 2006 in the Bank of England Quarterly Bulletin, he argued, how does the UK fund its deficit in trade and business services? And he answered, effectively, by becoming a large bank. And he asked the question, is this position sustainable? And he said, yes, it was sustainable. I don't know if he used the same analogy in 2008, I don't know if he had a large bank. But we have effectively turned our economy into a very large bank. And that's how we did it. But the extent to which the UK economy became financialized after Mrs. Thatcher's big bang is staggering. In 1987, the assets and liabilities of the UK financial sector, and that's the financial bit of the economy, its balance sheet, they were both about 400% of GDP, which you think. But by 2008, they'd grown to more than 1,500% of GDP. Okay, they dropped back a bit after 2008, but growth is now resumed, and we're still almost 1,400% of GDP. That sort of figure is huge by comparison to any other advanced economy. And it's not just our financial sector that is heavily into debt and the current market assets. If you look at the household sector, currently household debt is around about 100% of GDP. If you look at non-financial corporations, debt is about 260% of GDP. So we are an extremely heavily debt-laden economy, but particularly our financial sector. We have a global financial sector. London is serving, not just servicing the UK economy, it's servicing the world in a sense. But nevertheless, these figures are huge and out of line with anywhere else. In many ways, the most important thing is the international position. Because ultimately, you can't live by creating assets and liabilities within your own economy. Beyond a certain point, you can't eat bits of paper. We have to earn abroad the stuff that we need to get from abroad. And that depends upon the UK's international position. So it's interesting to look at the UK's international balance sheet. What I mean by that, I mean UK residents own assets abroad, and these assets have a certain value, and similarly, foreign residents own assets in the UK. And interestingly, the two quantities almost balance one another out. But if you look at what's been happening, this is the picture here, the picture is quite staggering. Now, what we have here, forget the line at the bottom, which is the net position, really, so two lines which are growing, which are interesting. These two lines, one is UK assets in the UK owned by foreign residents, so that's foreigners owning things in the UK, and the other line is foreign assets owned by UK residents. And the axis there is percent of GDP, so there's no inflationary effect here, correctly for inflation by looking at things, these quantities as a percent of UK GDP. You'll see that the growth is staggering and the magnitudes are staggering. You'll see that by 2008, both assets and liabilities had reached about 760% of GDP. That's way out of line with any other major economy. Things fell back immediately after 2008, but then growth resumed and we're now back at companies over 700% of GDP. What you've got there clearly is exponential growth, and the compound rate of growth as a percent of GDP has been about 8% per annum. Now that's a staggering figure, about 8% per annum growth, that means things double in about 9 years. So if things go on, that means that in 9 or 10 years,
the international assets and liabilities of the UK could be 1400% GDP. I'm going to suggest that's not a feasible scenario. If you think what we're doing, effectively, like a bank, we're taking in a lot of what we're taking in is deposits from abroad, and we're investing in equity-type investments in foreign companies. Now, if we think we're going to continue to do that and earn a return on our investments abroad, which exceeds what we have to pay foreigners to attract their deposits in the first place, then that implies that we are going to have to find a heck of a lot of very profitable investments around the world. We're going to have double the investments we've got at present in the next 5 years. In my mind, that's not feasible, particularly when you think that the pursuit of return already has led us into heavy exposure to dodgy bonds issued by European countries, has led us to be a banking sector to those heavily exposed to Chinese corporate debt, which is just about all accounts attend a firestorm. So our asset portfolio at present is by no means soundly based. It just seems inconceivable we could continue over the next 10 years to double it without anything badly wrong.
I'm not ready late thinking that the Bank of England has come out and said they actually are in such a rocky position that they couldn't go to the rescue of another major bank.
Well, that's right. But another thing I'm going to say, that another reason things are going to be likely to be unsustainable is that the last time in 2008, when we hit a problem, the public sector net debt in the UK was about 35% of GDP. What we did when we had that problem was effectively we took the dodgy assets of the private sector onto the government's book, and our net debt as a percentage of GDP doubled in a very few years. So we're now up in the 80-odd% of forecast to go higher. What that means is that if we do hit another problem, whatever the general needs problem is coming down the road, then the public sector doesn't have the capacity, which it just had last time, to step in to the breach. So it seems to me that we're in an unsustainable situation. We cannot keep this rate of growth going on. But on the other hand, our earnings in the city, to a large extent, depend upon the deals that we do. Depends upon not just having a large amount of assets, but growing that amount of assets. And it seems to me that we're extremely unlikely to be able to keep this up. So, to my mind, there is a very good chance within some point, I think almost certainly within the next 9 years, but when, I don't know, that a crisis in the Eurozone, that a crisis in China, that maybe one of our own banks getting badly wrong, will bring the whole caboodle grinding to a rather messy halt. So I do think that a systemic crisis in the UK economy is indeed a very real risk. And if you want to...
Could you say a wee bit about the fact that they actually used quantitative easing to help us out?
I'll be saying a little bit more about that in the next thing there. If you want to read a bit more about that, then there's a paper on our website, The Mismanagement of Britain, a record of the UK's decline in competitiveness, and why it matters, which goes into more detail on the sources and the figure I've just been talking about there. Okay, the next subject I want to talk about, and I'll hand back to Margaret, is the question of sharing debt. I mean, this is something that has been discussed, raised a great deal in the debate about the referendum. But to my mind, not much sense has been talked about it, and particularly not, I'm sorry to say, by the SNP. I mean, what trips off the tongue? If you look at the Paul Johnson Institute of Fiscal Studies on television, Scotland would have its population share of UK debt, that would be about 100 billion. The two bargaining positions in the Scottish Government's white paper are Scottish Government might take a population share of debt that would be probably share of about 130 billion, or it might take a share based upon a historic share of cumulative UK deficit, which would be around about 100 billion. So the SNP starting position negotiation is that we might take over between 100 billion and 130 billion of UK public sector debt. I'm going to argue that is complete and utter nonsense, and that the issues have not been currently explored with us. First question is, how big is UK public sector debt? Well, the headline figure around about 1.2 trillion. And that's all that's ever quoted. But, Mary mentioned quantitative easing. One of the ways we got out, temporarily, of 2008, is that the government opened gilt-edged securities for which they became the government edition. It did that to the tune of £375 billion. So effectively, debt certificates to the tune of £375 billion now sit in the drawer in the Bank of England, and the interest in that debt just recirculates into the bank through the Treasury. Effectively, that debt doesn't exist. And the theory is that, but as soon as things recover, we'll take the certificates out of the drawer and sell them back into the market, suck the cash out of the system, no risk of hyperinflation, and of course we haven't monetized our debt. Serious commentators are now saying that's never going to happen. The report of the Telegraph, I guess, I think you all get the Telegraph, should be very good transfer. The report of the Telegraph last week saying that the Bank of England itself is now signaling that this will not happen. Effectively, the UK almost certainly has monetized almost a third of its debt. Why in the heck is the S&P offering to take over a share of that debt which would never be monetized? Headline negotiations of debt should start with $800 debt, which has been called billion debt, which has been called the fees, rather than 1.2 trillion, part of which has been. Point one. Second point. There's a thing called the Vienna Convention, never ratified, but negotiated in 1983 by the UN, which governs how this type of business should be done. When a state sets up, how should the debt of the state be proportioned? And it lays out various important principles, one of which is discussion and agreement. The second is the principle of equity. And the third is that the negotiations should take account of the way in which the assets which were created that debt in the first place are split up between the states. So all of these principles should be taken into account when we're splitting debt. The Vienna Convention indicates why the population share business is completely wrong, because that doesn't take account of equity, and it doesn't take account of the sharing of assets. And we certainly don't want to take any debt over relating to climate. Okay. Let's do an exercise and consider what would happen if Scotland had been independent in 1980. Supposing that Scotland got its independence in 1980. We had the tax revenues as they were gathered, so we accept the relatively generous taxation regime that the UK government implemented in North Scotland. We take our share of the revenues, and everything else remains the same. We spend the same money that Scotland actually spent, and Scotland generates the same tax revenues which it actually generates. The only thing that's changed is that we are getting it. Our revenues, our government expenditure is the same, and we take over our population share of UK debt in 1980 and pay interest on that, but we don't take any more UK debt. Under that scenario, Scotland would relatively quickly have moved into, imagine Scotland having a bank account in which it paid the oil revenues, relatively quickly that bank account would have moved into surplus. And if we assume that Scotland then has a rate of return on that, we assume that the return then would be what the UK government would pay on 1 year gilt-edged securities. A technical reason for doing that is quite interesting. Other people have done the same, some of the Fiscal Commission did it and assumed that the Scottish government would earn 1% or 2% real. Gordon Atkinson Kent did it and assumed that Scotland would earn 4% nominal, which would be in fact a negative, -5% real. Depending on the assumption you make of the interesting error, at the end of the day, you end up with Scotland having a very substantial public cash flow. It would be 80 billion, 100 billion, 130 billion, or in our assumption, 150 billion. And that almost certainly is a consensus assumption. So, if we had our oil revenues, we wouldn't be looking at taking over 100 billion or 130 billion of UK debt. We'd be wondering how we'd spend our lump sum of 150 billion or more. In fact, it would almost certainly be larger than that for a number of reasons. First of all, because we would have made sure that the oil revenues, the actual oil activity took place in Scotland. We have 80% of oil extraction in the North Sea. We have 45% of the choice. We'd also have been encouraging the profits which are currently expanding the market to stay in Scotland. Not necessarily by tightening up the tax regime all that much, but just by tweaking it so that people get tax incentives for having headquarters there for recession development. There's all sorts of reasons why more of the actual oil activity would have taken place in Scotland, which would be the top of the period theoretic of some leading to 100 billion. So if Scotland had been independent in 1980, we would have had very significant oil and that surely is relevant to the negotiations when you think of the very principle of equity. The fact that we don't have that is relevant in terms of equity. In a paper which will be referenced in a minute, we make the distinction between a properly functioning union and a non-properly functioning union. And maybe in a properly functioning union you'd be prepared to say, let bygones be bygones. But in the paper we've given reference to, we give quotes from cabinet committee meetings saying, for goodness sake, keep quiet about the size of their own revenues, you know, of the Scots of the Afghans, more or less. In other words, they weren't open about this. They deliberately tried to squirrel it away and not let people know what was being done. So, why the heck should we not argue grounds of equity? The starting point in our negotiation should be, let's have 150 billion for us. Okay, we'll start talking from that. The other thing that's interesting is, to look what would happen if to the rest of the UK under the same scenario. And in our modelling, since we took the interest rate which the Scottish Government earned, what the UK Government would be paying 1 year real estate securities, then that translates naturally into looking at the mirror image of what would happen to the UK Government investors. And it's quite clear that in the early 80s, the UK would not have survived in the way it did. It would be in the worst position than when it was forced to go to the IMF in the mid-70s. And it would have been forced back to the IMF, and it would have had to change course. So in other words, the oil was used to prevent the UK undertaking the fundamental economic reform, which was necessary then and is equally necessary now. So, implications. The SNP's negotiating position that we start by taking over 197 billion pound in debt is nonsense. Starting about our negotiation, we can have 150 billion back. In no sense, if we refuse to take any over any debt, would we be defaulting. This argument that somehow if we didn't take over any debt, it's a default, is utter nonsense. And the other claim that's trotted out, oh well, but you've been subsidised all these years by the Barnett Fund, is nonsense. Because actually, the calculations that we did, which didn't have a 50 pound surplus, assume that the level of public expenditure took place, which did take place, as funded by the Barnett Fund. So in other words, we could have afforded the levels of expenditure we got under Barnett and still have 150 billion pounds a day. So these are important points. It seems to us that these points somehow have been missed off the radar in all the discussion about debt. And it's just used as something to bash the Yes campaign with, when in fact it should be one of our strongest suites. That's been there. One of our issues surrounding the shame of duty that was independence, and again, it's on our website. And so, what do you want?
Well, we've gone through three different things. We've gone through the dysfunction in the UK economy, we've gone through its macro mismanagement, and we've also looked at debt. The mismanagement has actually led to us, to the UK as a whole, being a rather awkward place if it wants to change itself. The productivity, if you look at any of the figures on it, is in chronic decline, particularly in relation to places like Germany, Japan, the United States. Jim's shown that the mismanagement of exchange rates and the way through, and with this chronic balance of payments, which is have been fueled here, have managed more recently on a chronic balance of payments to deal with it through massive borrowing. But in the early days, it was not the oil that met the bill. Now, however, we have to think, what can we do? Well, we can stay in the United Kingdom, and after all, Labour, Conservatives, and Lib Dems are all coming out with their ideas on what they're going to do, suddenly realise that there might be some inequality issues or some Scottish issues that they would like to address, and we've had a few pieces on this, particularly how it would affect income tax rates. Well, actually, the contingent income tax amount that comes to us all the like, and you'll find on their website a paper that says fiscal autonomy is not enough for Scotland. In fact, it could be a curse rather than a blessing. Because what you really need to have is real power. And real power on all the things recommend it, that you've got quietly, not the taxation, but what's behind it. I don't know if any of you ever played a game when you were young called Strip Jack. And it was one where you know, you've got a whole pack of 52 cards, but the only ones that are really worth having are the ace, the king, the queen, and the jack. And they manage to get the other points, and the rest of it's just rubbish. Well, I would say that what we are missing in Scottish devolution are only possession of the ace, the king, the queen, and the jack. We want to be able to determine where we spend our money. For example, do we want as much in defence, or do we want the same amount of money spent on different things in defence? We want to create a sustainable economy. You don't create a sustainable one by allowing debt-fueled mergers and acquisitions to be going on all the time. You want, in fact, to encourage startups. You want then to create the right environment for these startups to develop and have research and development. And you want somehow or other to have a firmer control at the end of the day so that they can, within Scotland, get the right backing on marketing, management, etc. Without thinking the easiest thing to do is to sell out and make a few million right away, because others should be involved, such as the workers and the rest of the society that's probably helped out with grants in the first place. You want to bargain properly with developers over the development of assets. As I said, whiskey is not owned by Scottish companies. The Crown Estates are a law unto themselves. North Sea Oil is owned by companies which have worked very well with the UK government to do rather well out of Scotland's assets. The universities, I don't honestly think are working necessarily for the benefit or optimising the benefit that could be having in Scotland as they first train our young people to go out the door, and when we looked at the industry relations, many of them are our companies outside of Scotland rather than helping companies within Scotland. We need to develop a very human approach to unemployment, disability, sickness, etc. Because any of these ones could be ourselves at some point in our lives. And we are not getting any flavour of that from the UK government. We want to ensure that no individual in society, whether they be rich or poor, are ripping us off. Tremendous attention is paid under Ian Duncan-Smith to how the poor might be rich, ripping us off. Very little attention is paid to the bonuses, etc., that are also ripping us off. And we want to do our own negotiations with other countries on matters, for example, such as fisheries and agriculture. So for all of these, I say we need independence.
And I think we want to sit at the table when international treaties are being negotiated. As at present, a deal is being negotiated between Europe and the US, which is going to hand incredible amounts of power to international corporations. And we're not going to be protected from that by the UK, which is a state which is funding the pockets of international corporations. Unless we get independence, we have no chance of that. Thank you very much.
Everybody hear that okay?
Yeah.
So saying that the system has become now that it's like a horse racing system where the same people own the horses, the vets, the bookies, the whole system, and therefore there's a lot of scope for fixing, libel type fixing of the system to suit the people that own the system.
Well, what I'm going to say is that where we independent, it would be up to the people in Scotland then to put in systems that prevented that happening.
Yeah.
As the system works just now, it's a low turnout, but we get a local authority and Scottish Parliament elections, we get the governments we deserve, and they could just end up being as corrupt as any other, or as ineffective or incompetent. It's really up to us. But we won't even get the chance unless we're independent.
Could I chip in and say that, I think the answer to your question is undoubtedly yes. But on the other hand, let's not be unaware of the difficulties. Because we, the UK, and Scotland within the UK, are thoroughly hooked on this particular drug, financialisation, and getting off it will not be easy. There's lots of things that could be done, but if you do them, then you may impact quite a large part of the UK economy and the Scottish economy at the same time. I mean, what could be done? We tend, speaking of the UK viewpoint, the city, the world leader, is a financial hub. We tend to view that as a national accolade bestowed upon us by God and virtue of our standard of property. And it just happens because we are in it. You know what I mean? In fact, it's not like that. A large part of the reason the city is so big is because standards are so lax. Give an example, there's a process called hypothecation and rehypothecation. Hypothecation is where you take out a loan and there's an asset which is hypothecated as collateral to that loan. You know, I have a bundle of securities, I go along to a bank. And I say, yeah, I have one of the securities, give me a loan, make it a loan, and here's the securities I have allocated as collateral. The bank then can take that on the securities, which is collateral for one loan, and use it as collateral for another loan, and the process is called rehypothecation. Now, within the UK, there's no limit for the extent to which that can be done other than prudent chaps, and not going to run into difficulties. In the US, there's a limit for the amount which business and rehypothecation. So if you're Goldman Sachs and you may have been people in America coming to your London security wanting loans again, you say, don't come to me, come to my London subsidiary, which I spent on session with this purpose, and they'll deal with you. Because Goldman Sachs tends to rule around much bigger through London just because there are no national rules there. So London is big because it's slackly regulated and also very corrupt. But unfortunately, it's easy to say, right, we'll tackle that. But what happens to London in the process? What happens to the UK economy, what happens to the Scottish economy? So we've got to recognise the downsides of that thing. It should be done. We need to de-financialise our economy in Scotland and the UK as a priority. But it's going to be less painful.
Next question. Could you stand up if you've got a question so that everybody can hear what you're saying? And also, if we can keep questions fairly short so we can get as many as possible.
I've got a couple, but I'll ask one and then I'll come back to one. One of the things you mentioned, and it's been mentioned with the Labour Party and their sort of Devo Max effort that they're coming up now, that they're scared about, and they're talking about things like, we'll give you the authority to raise more tax, right, in Scotland. One of the things they won't give us is corporation tax, and they won't give us VAT. Now, I'm led to believe that the receipts for VAT from Scotland in 1 year come to more than the entire North Sea revenue tax that we get in India. And yet we see none of that whatsoever. It's never been mentioned in the debate. You briefly mentioned it. And we were talking in that sum of money, and that goes directly to the Treasury. You don't see a penny of that. And yet every one of us is spending every day on VAT, yet we see none of it. And that has never been brought up in any debate I've heard so far. And that's a major amount of money, alone. So I was just going to ask him to
Well, the major reason why it's not up for grabs within the United Kingdom is because under EU legislation, the VAT is a country tax and our country is the UK, and they cannot discriminate around the different parts of the UK. What they can do is take, as the French have done, take a sector like tourism and reduce the rate for that sector throughout France. But you cannot say, under the way we are set up in the United Kingdom just now, that as a region within the United Kingdom cannot get reduction.
I'm not talking about a region, I'm talking about independence.
Well, with independence, of course, we would have it. Yes.
We would have that
absolutely
asset if we don't have it at the minute.
Which
would be an additional asset that's never been talked
it's
about.
It's one that the Yes campaign should take to heart. You're quite right that under the United Kingdom, you can't have a separate tax, VAT, legal level of Scotland. You can have it under independence. As well as that, we would also be able to use this aviation among the different sectors.
You mentioned about the damage, the calming implications you have on the Scottish economy. It's got money coming in from the block grants outside. How much time to look at Labour's Devo minimum proposals, but their tax varying powers and how that might affect the block grant money coming in Scotland? And would it actually reduce the money coming in and make things worse by giving us more tax powers?
I think there is an issue. The figures, Margaret, I think that's on the actual figures in the Labour.
Well, actually, it was a chap in the, I don't know if you ever read For Our Girl, which is a very good website. A chap from For Our Girl contacted us yesterday because he said he looked at the Labour proposals and there was no way that by their proposals just now in income tax, where they would be taking, if you remember, 15 pence. Scotland get 15 pence out of the 20 of the standard rate, and at the beginning it was 15 out of 40 for the next rate, but now we're saying we might increase the cover. And he said, we checked figures, that Labour were suggesting that we would be getting enough money out of that, those rates, that we'd be raising 10 billion. Well, actually, the whole of income tax. 10 billion in Scotland. So they're talking nonsense. But on the matter of that, so that's the bit I was dealing with. But on the matter of the variable rate, I mean, if indeed we were able to raise the 45p tax rate and the rest of the UK didn't, I think you would immediately get, first of all, the possibility of some companies who pay that type of money having getting employees down in London. But secondly, I think it was right that the packages a person gets, because if they're earning 150,000 or 200,000, I bet you can have it as so many share options for 140,000. So, tax avoidance is one.
Yeah, I don't know if that works. It's interesting to, we haven't looked at the specific number in the label, in detail. But we did do a detailed analysis of the original public deal, the one which is coming ahead, which is 10 billion in the pound. And what that does is it distorts the incentive to raise tax. It means that if you have the Scottish Government operating under Callow proposals, and the Scottish Government with exactly the same tax company power operating under independence, then under Callow proposals, there's always a greater incentive to raise tax compared with an independent. So the upshot is that we're liable to end up as a higher tax rate country operating under Calum than operating under, I mean, exactly the same sort of country under independence.
Going forward, all the data spreads from back in 1997.
Thank you. The old campaign loved to bring up independence, but more they're recommending join the parliament, and therefore they say that it's pointless being independent if the
United Kingdom to have banking or the Bank of Ascot taking economic policy, but somehow it's a bad thing for Scotland. Please explain.
Well, I'm not sure I can, but it's certainly the case that if we were if we were quasi-independent and in the monetary union with the UK, then certainly London would demand its price, and it would be a stringent price before they would agree. I mean, I think there's little doubt about that. But the other side of the coin is, you say, why is it all right for us to be in the monetary union at present? And my argument would be, it's not all right for us to be the monetary union. But I mean, I think the figures that Margaret quoted indicate quite clearly that this is a thoroughly malfunctioning monetary union in the UK. You've got gross disparity in different regions. The South East, London, has become a hotspot, which is sucking people and capital out of the talent, out of the rest of the country. And there's no sign of the government of Westminster either really recognising the problem or doing anything about it. I mean, it's fascinating to read the report of the Fiscal Commission. The Scotland's Fiscal Commission produced a report on the macroeconomic framework, which put forward this argument that independent Scotland should be part of the economic union. And it said, looked at various figures and said, look, you know, our GDP growth rate, our GDP per head, etc., is spot on the UK, virtually spot on the UK average, etc. Looked at various cycles, etc., and said, we move in line with the UK, we form an optimal currency in the rest of the UK. So that was a nonsense argument, because actually they didn't do the job they should have done, which is look not just at Scotland against the UK average, but as Margaret said, against Scotland, Wales, and Northern Ireland, and the regions of England. And when you look at it like that, you see that while Scotland may be close to the average, then there's huge dispersion between the other parts. So the UK itself, and you know, London and South East, the way up there, the UK itself is a thoroughly dysfunctional energy union, of which, to my mind, we want no part. But technically, you can have a monetary union the way we do, because there's no chance of Scotland pre-voting. I mean, Scotland, the first government cannot borrow, so it cannot rack up uncontrolled debts. And also, there is a potential for fiscal transfer between the different parts of the UK. Often regarded in the union's literature, the fiscal transfers have been from the rest of the UK to Scotland. In fact, the other way around, the fiscal transfers over the past 30 odd years have been from Scotland to the rest of the UK. But you've got the various sort of technical components that we need for a monetary union, which is fiscal transfers and no ability of one part to pre-load at the expense of the others. But you haven't got the actual functioning of a successful monetary union, and really, to my mind, we want a part of it.
You mentioned earlier that our starting position ought to be that we want this thing to do the building of the plan. Why do you think this that we work with the social and don't place that in the
You need to ask John Swinney why when this question of the quantum of easing was pointed out to him, he said, no, you're just taking the headline there from UK and stuff. It is just a misdirection that we have a group of very inept negotiators. Effectively, if you look at their stance on 100, taking on either 100 billion or 130 billion, that is the sort of position you might have come to at the end of the negotiation. You begin with a lot of a heck of a lot else. You might have said, oh, well, no circumstances agree to that. I'm not saying you should, but you can imagine that in the end, perhaps the end point in the negotiation. You don't start a negotiation to begin with that position. It just makes no sense whatsoever.
Question from that side of the room,
The first question I wanted to ask you is about, there was a report released by the Fiscal Commission to which there was an appendix by Joseph Stiglitz. Now, Professor Stiglitz is like probably the major development economist in the world. A massive public intellectual who's influential. And he said that the reason that the UK economy was in such trouble 270 times for poorest families out there. So my first question is about that. Do you agree that that is what Scotland would have to do? Would you rebalance wealth towards the poor? My second question is about the Nordic model. I'm currently trying to write an article tonight for the Sunday Herald on whether the Nordic model actually works. And my initial thoughts were, well, they have much more inequality in our society. And as a result, I remember reading in the Spirit Level by Wilkinson Pickett, they have 75% less homicides, 50% less mental illness, and they have 7 weeks a year more holiday than we do in the UK. So in the first level, it sounds like a great deal like a more beneficial society. On the other hand, it was also reading that in the last 25 years, income inequality in Sweden has risen faster than any other developed society, including the UK, albeit from a lower rate to begin with. So is the Nordic model viable, in your view, as an alternative to Scotland?
Well, can I answer the first one on rebalancing the income distribution? There is no doubt about it that our income distribution is disgraceful in the UK as a whole. The factors that influence, to my mind, the income distribution in Scotland are slightly different, because although we have a big financial sector in Edinburgh, it's not quite the same dominance as in London. However, that wealth distribution is also created by such things as land, which is a huge asset. And I think it was Truman Stevenson said just last year that that's the MEP, the Conservative MEP. In fact, it was getting far worse. We were handing money in pistols over these wind farms to large landowners. The way in which you rebalance income in an economy is not necessarily just though by taxation and by transfers. Those will always be needed. But what we saw very much also was that we would have things like a land tax. So if you're not properly using the land, you may pay more tax than somebody else who's using it effectively than them, but in Scotland. We would see much more coming from North Sea oil, and as we explained before, many more of the profits coming through. Therefore providing opportunities, therefore providing decent employment and career paths for young people. So taxation, etc., is all very relevant, but I think that Scotland needs as well, and possibly might have a longer effect, is a complete change in the way that the structure of our industry and the way in which we handle assets. And I would like to see licensing of whiskey distilleries, so that if they weren't actually doing most of the work here, paying a corporation tax here, then yeah.
On the Nordic model, I don't know the answer to that. I mean, what is the Nordic model? I think one has a sort of mental picture that maybe it's a sort of more equal society, high educational standards, high tech industry, relatively high taxation and high social welfare benefits, so that people are little disparity in income. But I don't know if that actually, to what extent that actually holds. And for example, in Sweden, there's been considerable privatization, and I think the increase in inequality you mentioned probably stemmed in large part from the considerable privatization, which stemmed in part from an earlier economic crisis. And I must admit, I have a problem with all economic models in that I don't myself see a paradigm. I mean, there's a view that the correct economic model, in some sense, is a bit like what I described as being that idealized view of the Scandinavian model, you know, that if you increase educational standards and go for a high-tech economy, etc., you'll get there. And sure, I mean, has any country solved the problems of sustainable, reasonable economic growth and then distributing the surplus in an equitable fashion? And it's very difficult to put the finger on any country that has obviously done that. And I think we need to be
any questions from ladies. So if anybody female wants to have a question or thinks of a question, please don't be shy to put your hands up. So I do want to encourage everybody to get involved, but I'm aware it's predominantly male audience as well.
Yeah, sorry, just follow this up by the way, may I ask a question at this moment, because it's a question about other economic models, and I'd suggest, and I'd be interested in what your views are, that a lot of our projections of the future are based essentially on different paradigms from the past being projected for the future rather than looking back from that. And so can I just float a couple of the ideas that have been thought about a bit in the last year or two? One of them came from Ray Pinto, who's the Neural's Officer for Microsoft, who suggested at a conference in Hollywood a couple of years ago now that actually Scotland was in a remarkably strong position, because he believed that what was underpinning currency in the future was the interchange, this in the digital age, is the interchangeability of our renewable energy as an underpinning of currency and its ability to be converted into the processing of data for the vastly growing sector of the world economy. The other, which is closely related to that, is somebody called Chris Cook, who came down and spoke at one of our Small Communities Housing Trust events, who also said something rather similar. He was suggesting that to solve the housing problem, we needed to be thinking of a way in which you could actually factor in the value of that predicted value of generating renewable energy in the future to be able to underpin now that what you're borrowing against the guarantee of renewable energy, because it's always going to be there, as opposed to the guarantee against a non-renewable energy source, which won't always be there, as an underpinning of public finance at the present time, and Chris Cook's been writing and speaking a lot about that in different places subsequently. So, just curious to hear your thoughts on both of those.
Well, on Chris Cook's one of those, it reminds me very much of, what was the fellow's name? Is it Green, White, or Black? Rangers?
White.
Reminds me very much of the fellow at Rangers, White, who managed to borrow on his friend.
I
managed to borrow forward of him, therefore, on the expected ticket sales in the future. Because I don't think that we're saying, you know, that renewables are there and will always be there. But the actual cost of getting renewable energy is very high, as witnessed by our bills, and as witnessed also by the latest one from England, that we possibly won't get the energy from us, because our energy will be too expensive. We'd rather go to Canada and spare limiting energy. So I'm a bit concerned about a model which is predicated upon something like renewables, which is not, although it's always there, could be extremely expensive to get and fluctuates in global markets.
If I could chip in on that, which is it? I mean, renewables worries me for precisely the reason I said. I think we're going down very expensive for some renewables. And I mentioned earlier the problems with the UK model of utility pricing and how that is expensive for consumers. Now, if we say a little bit more about that, there's a variant of that model which is operated by the Office of Rail Regulation for funding of rail capital infrastructure, which is even more expensive variant. And unfortunately, something very like that, also rail regulation, is used in the reimbursing the capital costs of renewable energy. So we've made some big mistakes in the way we started on renewable energy, in that we're building in a very expensive way of doing it. Now, that should be correctable. In my view, too many contracts have been signed. So that needs to be corrected. And the technology that needs to come out of it before we can really bank on renewable energy.
Do you mean energy storage technology, primarily, or...?
And the generation technology as well, I think. I mean, I'm not an expert in the actual technology used, but I do know a little bit about the pricing model used for the capital thing, and that certainly is wrong, and we've made a big mistake there. And we need to be slightly careful that we don't get stranded on the renewable thing. If we sign a lot of contracts which are unbreakable for renewable energy, it's going to be very expensive. And then, independent Scotland, the UK, and other sources don't want to buy our new managers. Alex Allen was very keen, for example, that there's the unified energy market across the UK after independence, precisely because
cross-charging, look at it from a cohort perspective, that brings in this question of the challenge.
Lucy, I've got something. I've got a question from a woman, and then the other person from Chris afterwards. I suppose it'll be the concern by there's a lot of emphasis on oil and getting oil and getting benefit from that, and they're sort of saying that renewables thing, it's going to be also in the net. But I mean, if that's premised on commercial contracts, you're not really talking now about things like community ownership and cooperative renewable energy. And I think it's maybe a bit of a kind of idea to say that renewable energy is going to disaster. You're just talking about large companies and the existing kind of ex-monopoly companies controlling, but we're actually talking about communities, which is why we don't see an independent Scotland, we wouldn't want it just to be business as usual. I think that we could actually just be quite interesting and a positive contribution to our children's future and that. That wasn't really the question, it was more just
interesting.
Just what do you think about the role of community ownership and cooperatives and things like that? And
it would be wonderful if it was genuine community ownership, but as you well know, if you go upstate at a local, you find that the local community has agreed for a wind farm to go there. And they get paltry amounts of money in a village hall or something, while the landowner got a considerable amount. So it wasn't true community involvement. You speak of something, a good step up from that.
But I mean, in the island communities, where there's land ownership already, then energy ownership is just sort of the natural the next step. So I mean, that's what it is in different context. But I would hope to see from an engineer in Scotland that the land is owned by people in Scotland and include for
them. Also, I'm just thinking of that. There are things like spiritual values, and wind co-op, which set up recently, which is a more localised community value, and that does seem to be kicking off more as well.
I couldn't agree more. I mean, certainly what we don't want is to lock in. Through James, I think, said that the transfer, the way landowners are currently being reimbursed for wind farms is the greatest transfer of resources to the landed classes, I think, since the Reformation. Mm-hmm. What happens just now is grotesque and horrendous. By all means, if we can get proper community ownership, if we can get benefit, let's do that. But let's not just use the current models for it, and let's use proper pricing models, and let's get the technology right as well.
I'm kind of guessing from what you've already said that you don't support the idea of a currency union. I'm wondering then what, in order to get maximum power, whether you support the idea of an independent currency. And if you do, if you could talk a little bit about that and some of the difficulties that are put in its way by governments.
I don't want to say too much about that because I think it's an extremely difficult area. I certainly don't support the country union with the rest of the government. I don't think it would be good for us, and I don't think it would be independent. I do support the idea of the Scottish currency. But what's not been addressed is the transitional issues. And the transitional issues are very serious. And I think it's a huge flaw. The whole referendum process, that the aspirational case for independent Scotland had been made well, and completely inadequate attention has been paid to the transitional issues of getting either into from what we call the currency or into the EU, or the EU or into NATO or anything like that. It is almost grotesque, the lack of attention to the details, which really needed to place before a referendum was called. And since Alec had piled up these problems, he should answer them. And I don't see it really speculating on the answers or flagging my difficulties.
The
difficulties are there.
The going to have been to the longer run, which is that if I'm allowed to do that, then I think the paper that we pointed out earlier on about this functional economy shows quite clearly that Scotland does not form with the other regions of England, or with the regions of England, with Wales and Northern Ireland, it does not form what's called an optimal currency area. And that being the case, then that itself answers the question that currency union is not a good idea. In fact, we would, and we have have argued for long enough, even when Eddie George was the head of the Bank of England before Mervyn King, and he came up to Newcastle, and in Newcastle was asked, well, what are you doing, Mr. George, about the unemployment levels? And his response was, I manage the inflation rate, and of course the inflation rate is very much a function of what's happening in the City of London, affecting the rest of us, as that affects wages and so on. And so the Bank of England had nothing to say to the North or Scotland about unemployment. We just can't run at that.
Do we have any questions from anybody that haven't already asked one?
Yeah.
I've been thinking about the universal basic income, and I haven't heard anybody talking about that in Scotland. I just wondered, as economists, whether you knew anything about the affordability of that. I mean, people have said that because of the less bureaucracy in administering, it's not being tested, that it's a good way to distribute wealth. I just wondered whether you knew anything about the affordability and sense of that kind of scheme.
I mean, obviously, this scheme hasn't been properly, as you said, tested yet. So as far as I can gather, it's going to appeal worries over such things as housing benefit, on the way through, and things like bedroom tax. I really, I'll be as ignorant. You probably know more than us. Sorry about that.
I'm skeptical of the idea that if we know quite well Andy Miller is one of the main proponents of community, it's a similar idea. And she's a lovely person. But I suspect she may well have overestimated the perfectibility of human nature.
This actually was really John. When you're speaking of where you join all the benefits together.
Universal income does it for any.
Annie Miller first approached the idea of this to me 30 odd years ago, and I thought it crazy at the time, insofar as many of us would not take up a benefit because we wouldn't like to think that we needed it, even if we did need it. So that's the one end of the spectrum, and another group will take it, and in fact they should be trying to see if they've got more prospects themselves for doing something when they get those. So you've got this huge problem of a universal credit that you may in fact be giving to some people, and it's a disincentive to them. But at the same time, I've also got a problem with, suppose in fact you were a district nurse and you've been working all your days and you've got a pension which you can, it's going to be very small, and then people next door to you haven't been working hard at that at all, and they suddenly get virtually the same amount as you've got, which happened to me when I first started work in ICI, and at the end I was the only person employed in the first year of the graduate intake, and the next year four young men started. And because it was unequal pay at that time, they had a pound of a difference between me and them at their disposal. So people have all these tensions, and I don't know how best I should solve it.
I'll ask it like a statement and a question at the same time. With regard to this gentleman here, when he was talking about the Bank of England being last resort, I think the answer to the question earlier on, they said that they're now in a position where they couldn't get out of another bank, and you're saying that was the position that's come up. So it can't be a bank at a last resort. It's impossible now.
They could. I mean, the Bank of England can always print the money if it did last time. The question will be, how often can they try that trick before the international community calls foul?
The second thing I was going to say is, I was, like some of you here, I can see some of you, I was lucky enough to be brought up and working in the 1970s, before all this disaster befell us. when we came, and I lived, I come from Motherwell originally. My Motherwell was a steel making town, right? And loyalty businesses. One thing I was going to say was privatisation, not privatisation, but nationalisation. Back in those days, we had nationalisation, which everybody suddenly in the 1980s become a dirty word. But what people didn't realise about that was that these nationalised companies also propped up a lot of private companies that were either selling goods to them, buying goods from them, steel stockholders, small clockworks, Honeywells, various other companies, right? That depended on nationalised industry to make money, right? And to keep it going. Now, I saw that in the 1980s decimated, right? Absolutely decimated. Ravensgrave and Motherwell broke production records for Europe. They were the most productive steel workers in Europe. And they broke production records 17 times. And yet they closed the factory. Right? Not because it wasn't profitable. It was profitable, it was government legislation. One of the things that made it unprofitable was they wouldn't subsidise transport for the steel, which other countries did, right? Therefore, it was actually cheaper to buy steel 2 miles away and buy it from Sweden, because their transport costs were less than transporting it 2 miles up the road to the Ravensgrave, which was nonsense, right? That was political dogma. Now, in the 1980s, what we saw was Margaret Thatcher stating that in the 1980s, she wanted Britain, i.e. London, to be the service sector for Europe and the world, which is what she went on this bender doing. And she destroyed most of her traditional industries up and down the country. Absolutely destroyed them. Couldn't care less as long as the city was satisfied. So we're now in the position.
Can we just get to the
point? I'm getting to the point, but I have to point this out first. I'm now in the position where no government in this country, in the United Kingdom, can control what the city is doing. Right? You stated that in Northern Lamont when we had Black Friday. That for the first time you realised that the government didn't have control over the city, which is what you were saying earlier on. Now, if we get independence, we have our own stock market, we have our own deals. We need to put safeguards in place to make sure the same thing doesn't happen here. And the other thing is there no time to talk about nationalisation again? Like, say, power, things like that, bringing it back in-house to stop all these... I mean, I remember the days when I could afford to pay any electricity bill. You know, no, like now. To me, it's just been greed over greed over greed. So all these things and your new ideas, your new industry, any new government's going to have to sit down and talk about the way ahead, talk about what they're going to do, how they're going to do it, how they're going to create jobs, yeah? And what money they've got to spend to do that. So I was just going to ask you what your thoughts are on the likes of nationalisation.
On the nationalisation, it's conflicting thoughts, because it's quite clear, you mentioned the car industry, it's quite clear that every now and again they say the lights might go out. In other words, the planning has not taken place, and one of the things that the public sector did when it was in charge of our basic utilities was plan ahead. You might object to that, and if you do, please let me know. However, on the other hand, we do have one major nationalised industry left, or public sector company, Scottish Water. And if you look at our website, you will see that they think the Scottish Water, even though it is owned by you and us, in fact operates like a private sector company, has shared labour phenomenally, brings in every year companies which are not even from the UK, not even from England and Wales, but actually from right outside the country, and the government appears to have no control.
I mean, another comment on nationalisation. In the utility sphere, there's actually a very strong argument for nationalisation from my point of pricing. By mentioning how the current pricing model in utility, in charging for utilities capital investment is far
cheapest way of funding capital investment is just to fund it direct from revenue, straight from charges. You cut out the financial sector altogether. There's a transitional problem because you can't move straight to that, but really, you know, talking a long time here, and government could plan easily to move towards that system, and that would be very much cheaper than any financialized alternative. But one of the reasons you can't do that is because the privatized utility companies are relatively small, and the capital investment stream is lumpy, so you've got to do some smoothing. With nationalization, when you're dealing with larger blocks, and you have a much smoother capital investment program, and you could consider these more radical alternatives. So there is a lot to be said, you know, for a variety of reasons, for some nationalization programs. But Margaret says, no panacea, and you've really got to control these things properly, or then you're better off.
Actually, I'd just very quickly say another problem with the denationalisation by the speak of gas. As you well know, although we have Scottish Gas, it's only a trade name and it's owned by Centrica. And looking at Centrica's accounts for last year, this might make something go in your brain. You think, I've heard this story before. Centrica is fascinated by the northeast of the states and it wants to expand its markets in the northeast of the states. Remember RBS? Did exactly the same. It's expanded by buying companies there, using debt to fuel it. Its debt is over $5 billion, I think, at the minute. It might be larger. Its assets are not much bigger. And it's actually moved into the States at the very time that you're. Because what's happening in the current States? Fracking. So it's faced immediately after 6 months extremely difficult markets. Who's that going to impact upon? So that's another reason for nationalisation, that to trim the wings and keep them supplying what they're meant to be doing, which is the utility in the country they're meant to be in.
We'll have another couple of quick questions. So if we keep the question short, we'll have time to look at it.
So I just want to come back into the currency thing. I've heard that certain reasons why.
They continue just to be expatriated, then that's a very good answer. And good, you need to deal with that as well.
One of the players I've heard when I've got discussing before is him, who's back to the debt and deficit and balance of payments. One of the calculators I use that's been bandied over the internet and I've been using it quite a lot. I'm just wondering if I can check with you just how accurate it is. Talk about the current balance of payment deficit. The whole of the UK is in the
the rest of the UK doesn't. Can I answer that bit? And as all these other bits, so I really think the best thing would be to let your email address to look figures up, because otherwise there's no point to talk to
them. But I mean, if I come back at what I just made, it's not about the flows of goods. You also have to deal with the income flow, and there's a huge income flow to cope with as well. That means that our current balance, not just in goods and services, but income flow, would not be as good on independence unless it is.
As far as the government in the last few months, since the ASIC is saying he's having a hands-off approach to the whole process, and it's for the Scottish people to decide. And it's come to light that there have been a vast number of diplomatic cables attempting to sabotage every single part of the process, e-membership, everything. Shouldn't he have deal to convince Spain? They're not breaking on separate state either. But do we know what extent the sabotage is unsuccessful?
I mean, I think the sabotage is much deeper than some diplomatic dirty tricks. We're going to talk next week about the Edinburgh Democratic Society, where we're looking at the referendum debate. And the title of the talk, Margaret Hayes, is the medium is the message, or the medium is very much the message. And making the point, what we're trying to do is make the point that the debate has been very much conditioned by the statistics that have been collected and the analyses that have been done, and that's had a huge effect. I mean, we mentioned one tonight, which is the fact that the UK presents its headline debt figures are still being 1.2 trillion, has had a massive effect on the debate, what share of debt is dropping by state over quantity of these companies. The whole JERS business, and we're not going to mention members of Scotland, this annual report that was produced since 1992, which showed the flow of government, actually the government account, but also in this initially with this handle was not to be written. And the debate focused upon that. But they didn't produce the figures of the other flows that we're talking about. You know, we don't have proper trade figures for Scotland, income flows, etc. So the healthy balance, that hemorrhage of funds that we should have seen, we should have been listening to debate, wasn't written down, wasn't measured, and so never really hit the debate in the way it should have done. So you don't need to actually indulge in dirty tricks if you're controlling what analyses are being produced. Another example, the Institute of Fiscal Studies produced a massive report last November, which showed that Scotland was going to run into demographic problems greater than England, the rest of the UK would run into. Now that report was funded by us, it was funded by the Social Science Research Committee, a huge today. And their starting point is, well, take the Office of Budget Responsibility forecast of the UK GDP. Take that as a given, and then split that up in a different way. But if you're taking that as a given, the OBR is very optimistic about the UK economy. It's assuming that we're back on track by the end of 5-year forecast period of low inflation and trade growth. It's not taking any reckoning of the sort of danger of systemic crisis. So if you take that forecast as a given, then automatically you're throwing the whole debate on the risks of Scotland. And you're just not looking at the risks attaching to GB. So you don't need to do dirty tricks. You just set up the analysis and break it away and the rest follows.
I do think actually that even without David Cameron, Scotland has major work to do, because in the EU it's unanimous voting, and it's really in Spain to say that we wouldn't accept as in straight away first of trouble. And it's quite clear that Barroso, etc., are taking that view. The other problem is in EFTA, that the biggest prize in EFTA is the European Economic Agreement. And again, that is signed individually by all the different members of the EC. So it's not a simple matter that we'll get into EFTA. So we really have to do a massive charm offensive and show that we are not we're not a threat, that what happens to us would necessarily happen to Venice, Chechnya, Barcelona, etc. But they did this in 1707. They would write the embassies then to tell them according to Peter Winchester.
It's interesting, not long back from this, when our
So we really need ourselves to be writing to all these places to show where.
You have your website address again, please.
It's www.cuthbert1.pwp.blueyonder.co.uk.
But if in Google you put in our names, it'll come up anyway.
Jim and Margaret
Cuthbert.
Well, I might get the
one last question at the back, and then
I briefly want to come back to what you said about universal basic income, because I have done a little bit of research.
Well, more than we have.
it's advocated by people on the far left and the far right. It's an interesting thing. The one example of it that's ever really worked is Alaska, where essentially, just for living in Alaska, you get $2,000 per year to live there. But most of all, people advocated because they want an alternative to the currently constituted welfare and public sector system. I think therein lies the danger of the concept, because ultimately it does have sort of neoliberal potential implications, which is to use this as a okay, rather than have some specific designated welfare benefit, we'll give you this one sort of cash, and that's what you'll have instead. Now, I understand why there is a critique of the existing bureaucracy. One thing that is a little bit better, I don't know if anyone's heard of this, is the Porto Alegre model in Brazil. And basically what they do there is participatory budgeting. They give the local community a certain amount of money, and the local community meets up in local assemblies and decides how they're going to spend that, whether it's on a new health clinic, a new bridge, whatever it happens to be. I wonder whether that model of participatory local budgeting could be one that Scotland could use after independence. And lastly, I just wanted to agree with what Lucy said. I think if you look at the comparison between Denmark and the UK on windmills, there's far more windmills in Denmark, a much smaller country, than there is in the UK. And why is that? It's nothing to do with the physical geology or anything of the country. It's because the windmills there are community owned. Whereas we have the problem here, ultimately, of 432 people own 50% of Scottish private land, and most of it is in private hands. Therefore, the real problem for me is not one to do with renewable energy, but it's one to do with the way that we use our land in this country.
I think hopefully everybody has got the questions that they wanted to do. I know we've covered a lot of questions and a lot of ground. I think it's been a really well-informed, fascinating talk. We've covered a whole range of aspects of Scotland's economy, from land ownership to welfare to taxation. So I'd like to thank everybody for coming out. I'd like to thank Lucy for organising it. I'd like to particularly thank Jim and Margaret for bringing a huge amount of knowledge and experience along to this. A couple of things to say before we're going. We do have to pay for part of the room, so there's a bucket at the back there for paying for the room, and anything left over will go towards paying for RIC D&G leaflets. There's also t-shirts and badges, the coolest t-shirts in the independent movement, if anyone hasn't already got one or two or several, there's some there.
Lucy
can take one that's all in different colours if you don't want green or yellow or whatever there. There's one event I've got to announce upcoming, which is Sunday the 30th of March, which is the week on Sunday. It'll be a mass leafleting event of the Britons for the Rich leaflet, Troquet at Dumfries, and meet outside the church on Troquet Road at 12 o'clock on Sunday.
You were going to pronounce that one, but it's Troquet.
Right, okay, thanks very much, everybody.